Patterns is a 40-point Linux machine on Hack2Box. For user, we exploit an external entity injection in a Word document and a local file inclusion that involves path traversal and calculating the name of an uploaded file. For root, we use return-oriented programming to exploit a stack overflow in a TCP server. After scanning the box, we see SSH, Apache, and an unknown service on port 8888. We look at the website and can see a list of patterns and a form that allows us to upload .docx files, which are then converted to PDF. Before trying to exploit this upload form, we fuzz the server a bit to look for hidden files and directories. After fuzzing the releases directory, we find an interesting file called update details. When we look at this file in Firefox, we can see some hints that were placed. There seems to be some endpoint that was vulnerable to a directory traversal and local file inclusion. Unfortunately, we don't know the endpoint. Also, there's a note about entity parsing, which is enabled in a custom folder. This is a very interesting hint, as docx files are just a collection of XML, and external entity injection attacks are usually not possible in the default files. So let's search a bit what this custom folder thing could be. We find a blog post on sap.com where they describe how to use custom XML in a Word document. It seems that you have to create a folder called custom XML and drop an XML file in there. According to the hint, an XXE attack might then be possible in this XML file. To get started, I saved a normal docx document in Word and copied it to my VM. We upload the docx and can see that it has been indeed converted to a PDF. If we click download, we can see that it has a name that seems pretty random. We now look at the document in more detail. First, we unpack the file with 7-zip and can see that it's indeed a collection of XML files. We create a folder custom XML as described in a blog post and a file called item1.xml where we will try to host the payload. We use a simple XXE attack vector, which you can also find on payload all the things, which includes an external DTD file and then tries to reference the entity. We start a local web server and also create the DTD XML file, which has a payload that will use a PHP filter to compress and base64 encode a file which we specify, in this case etc parsed.wd. This file is then sent back to us via another entity called xfill. After making the changes, we zip the docx file again and upload it to the server. We can see on our Python HTTP server that the target indeed requested the DTD file and also sent us the contents of the parsed.wd file. We use CyberChef to remove compression and base64 encoding and can view the contents. We continue by retrieving another file, this time the virtual host configuration of the Apache web server that is running. After uploading the document again, we can see the full path of the web root. This is important because we can now start to retrieve the source files of the web application. After running another quick fff to see the available PHP files, we decide to grab config.php as a next file from the web root. This file shows something interesting. Apparently there's a file called getPatent_alpha and so on, which we obviously couldn't find by fuzzing. This is the hidden endpoint we were thinking about earlier when we looked at the hint file. We go to this new page and can see that it takes an ID parameter. We try a few random things but don't really get anywhere, so we continue by grabbing the source of this file as well. After getting the file, we can see how the processing of the ID parameter is implemented. The application tries to strip path traversal sequences out of the parameter by removing the dot dot slash and then includes the file into the page. This path traversal protection can be easily bypassed by adding additional dot dot slash sequences in every existing sequence, so that after the removal step, we still have valid ones left. We try to include etc parsed.wd again, this time via the LFI we just found. By adding the additional sequences, we bypass the filter and can see the contents of the file again. Now, the interesting thing is that this is not just a file read, but an actual include, which means that if we can include a file that contains PHP code, we would get code execution. The question is just what file we can include. It would be really nice if we could include the document we upload and have some kind of PHP in there. We retrieve the source of convert.php and can see how the name of the uploaded file is generated. The name we provide when uploading is used as the base name. This base name is concatenated with the current time and then hashed with SHA-256. The path gets constructed by prepending uploads and appending the .docx extension. This is all done before any checks happen whether this is actually a .docx file. We can see that the file is moved to the uploads folder with the name we just saw. However, there seems to be no visible code that deletes this temporary file. We can exploit this by writing a short Python script that gets the time from the web server, turns it back a bit, generates the correct file name as you just saw, and then requests the file over and over again with incrementing timestamps. At some point it will hit the name of the hidden temporary file. Note that the step is a bit tricky and might take a while to get it working right. Try to play with the time delta or use your local time if you have trouble hitting the file. We upload the file, run the script and wait for the output. I got a bit impatient and used Intruder to upload a ton of files to increase my chances. Eventually we find the uploaded files and can now use them in the LFI we got earlier. We confirm in Firefox that we can include the file and get command execution. To get a shell on the target, I use curl to download the script from my box that will run a Perl reverse shell. After sending the payload, we indeed get a reverse shell back. We upload PSPAIR on the box and run it. After a moment, we can see a command that is running, which includes the root password. We use the password to change users to root, however, as we are in a container, there is no root flag yet. In user source LFM, we find the Git repository, which we zip and copy into the web root, so we can download it to our box. In Git log, we can see several interesting commits. The most important ones are the ones where the executable was added, which we must exploit in the next step, and the commit two commits before that, which holds an early stage of the source code of the binary. We grab the binary and have a look at the source. The interesting file here is lfm.c, which contains the majority of the relevant code. We can see that three methods are supported: check, get, and put. When scrolling down a bit, we however see that the implementation is somewhat missing all of them. There's one more component which is important for this exploitation step. In the op directory, there's a script that acts as a Python client to the LFM binary. Here we can see how commands look like, which is very helpful. We can see that we have the command verb, a path, a username, a password, and an MD5 hash when using the check function. Also, since we did not do it earlier, we use the user flag. Now we'll go through the steps that are required to exploit the binary. We start by running strings and can see the various status codes the server uses in addition to the username and the password it expects. It also seems to use a config file in etc and a local log file. Our initial POC looks as follows. This is a simple pwntool script that will connect to the server and use the same command that we saw earlier on the Python client on the container. We request the file notes.txt in this example, which I created locally in a files subdirectory. By running the server with strace-f, we can see the file it opens. When running the POC, we can see that it indeed tries to access files/notes.txt and succeeds. Note that the status code 406 is given because we did not specify a valid hash and instead just sent don't care. When we send the correct hash, we get 200 OK back. For the exploitation, it doesn't matter whether the hash is valid or not. The next step involves some trial and error to see whether path traversal is possible. Eventually, it became clear that if the traversal sequence gets URL encoded, it succeeds. Now we replace the file with a bunch of URL encoded A's to provoke a crash. You can fast forward this crash, for example with BooFast, or just try to send a huge buffer in various positions of the payload. When sending a payload, we notice that there is no status code being sent, the thread that handled the request crashed. We restart the server in GDB and send the payload again to get some insight. We can see that we crashed inside the strtoul function, but we don't really control any interesting registers. We can take the address from the backtrace and have a short look in IDA. We do not have a function name, but it's a reasonable guess that this function has something to do with URL encoding. Now, for the next step, we combine having a valid file as a target with the idea of sending a large buffer. Again, you can get this by fuzzing, reversing the binary, or just trying a bunch of payloads. We observe another crash, and this time the registers look way better. We have control over the instruction pointer. A short look in IDA reveals that this return is the one at the end of the main function that does the request processing. As with most other exploits, we generate a pattern to get the correct offset of the instruction pointer override. One way to generate this pattern is pattern.py, which I linked in a blog post. After crashing the binary again, we can use pattern.py to resolve the pattern to an offset. We continue by setting up the payload so it sends Bs at the position of the rep override, followed by a bunch of Cs. The GDB output shows that the offset was correct. Now we have to think about the actual payload we want to send. Since this is a TCP server, we can use the write method on the file descriptor of the connection to get data from the server. Since we are dealing with a non-executable stack, we have to use ROP to achieve that. The short chain uses two gadgets, pop-RDI and pop-RSI-R15, to fill the RDI registers with the file descriptor and the RSI register with a libc address that we want to leak. Calling write then will send this address to us. Now, for the file descriptor, the simplest way is to just try a few, especially when doing it against a remote endpoint. The gadgets we can get with ROPer. We run the exploit by having a breakpoint on a return where our chain starts. After hitting the breakpoint, we can step through the chain and see that everything is set up correctly. After running the exploit without debugging, we can see that we have indeed leaked the libc address, in this case the one from malloc. Now we need to obtain the offset of the malloc function from the address libc is loaded at. Remember that we know the target version 2.28 from the README inside the Git repository. To exploit it locally, we however have to use our own libc instead. An easy way to get the offsets is to load the libc in GDB and use print. After entering the correct offset, we can see that we got the base of libc right. Let's look at the next step. Now that we have the base, I disabled the leak code and hardcoded the value we got earlier to make it a bit simpler. The payload we are going to use to exploit the binary consists of 3 dub2 calls followed by 1 gadget. This allows to reuse the existing connection for our shell. The dub2 calls will duplicate the file descriptors for standard in, standard out, and standard error to our socket so we get input and output if we spawn a shell from the server process. I added a link to a nice blog post about this technique. The one gadget is an address in libc which will give us a shell if we jump to it, without requiring additional shellcode or setup. The Ruby tool one gadget identifies 3 such addresses for us in our local libc. We restart the server with GDB and run the exploit, and can now step through our ROP chain. All dub calls are working out and we land in the execve method, which is what we wanted. Unfortunately, this crashes because we don't fulfill the conditions the one gadget requires. However, for the target libc, there's a one gadget that will work. Now we are almost done with the exploitation process. Our next POC is identical to the one we used to leak libc, just this time we are connecting to the remote server. We update the final exploit POC with the leaked libc base address and set a new one gadget that fits the libc on the target. I got a libc version that is running on the remote end from the README and downloaded it from the link you can find in my blog post. We run the exploit and get a shell. Unfortunately, it dies quickly if no input is provided. To get around that, we quickly spawn a Perl reverse shell. And the box is still not complete. There is no root flag in root's home folder. It turns out that another folder was mounted over the root folder. As soon as we are unmounted, we can read the flag and have finally finished the box.